Hello, my name is Alma Robinson, and I am the Executive Director of California Lawyers for the Arts. CLA is a statewide nonprofit organization that was founded in 1974 to serve artists and arts organizations of all disciplines with advocacy as well as services that provide support with legal and business issues. With staffed offices in San Francisco, Berkeley, Sacramento, Los Angeles, and San Diego, we provide several core services. First, we provide legal counseling to specialized attorneys who provide assistance with a variety of intellectual property questions, as well as contract reviews and negotiations, and other important business issues. Depending on the client's financial status, legal assistance may be available on a pro bono or reduced fee basis. We also provide a specialized program that assists independent inventors and small startups with their patent applications. To help with situations involving disputes, we provide a range of alternative services, including negotiations counseling, mediation, and arbitration that can avoid the expense and hassle of going to court. Finally, we offer a full menu of educational programs that include workshops, symposia, and conferences on various legal topics for artists and arts organizations. Many of these programs are posted on our YouTube channel, and we encourage you to use these tools to educate yourself on the legal issues before you reach out for specialized assistance from our organization. Thank you for joining today's program. And please consider joining CLA on our website at www.calawyersforthearts.org so that we can continue to maintain our full range of services. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for being here at our special lecture with Professor Kevin Greene, Intellectual Property at the Intersections of Race and Law. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Professor Greene, who will be our speaker for tonight. Professor Greene's scholarship in areas of copyright, trademark, and publicity rights has garnered national and international recognition in the intellectual property arena, particularly his pioneering work on African American music and copyright. His scholarship has twice been selected as among the best IP law review articles in 2008. For a right of publicity article, and in 2015 for an article on idea misappropriation in Hollywood. A graduate of Yale Law School and a veteran of the United States Marines, Professor Kevin J. Greene is joining Southwestern Law School as faculty in January. Before becoming a law professor, Greene practiced law in New York at the premier firm of Cravath, Swaine and Moore, where he represented high-profile companies such as Time Warner and HBO. Please join me in welcoming Professor Kevin Greene.
Thanks so much, Diana, for that wonderful introduction. And today I'm going to be presenting this talk on the copyright House of Horrors and Other Tales from the Dark Side. This is a part of a book project that I'm working on, which tells a story about the work that I've been doing for 20 years now, pretty much, about African-American creativity, and particularly African-American music and the law, particularly copyright law. So that's what I'd like to share for you today. The House of Horrors is a metaphor for the treatment, we might say the mistreatment, of African-American music artists from the earliest era of the United States, ragtime through the blues and up to today through hip hop. And so I'd like to talk to you a little bit about my work today in this area. I want to thank California Lawyers for the Arts, though, first of all, for giving me this opportunity to present here. Very excited to be here. I also want to particularly thank Diana and the rest of the team, including Alma, the president of the association, and really enjoyed that video. So thank you so much, California Lawyers for the Arts. You guys do great work. You help a lot of people. You help people who really need the help in this area. And I'm much appreciative of that and very proud to be here under your banner. So part of my project has been looking at copyright justice, because we've had a good deal of copyright injustice over the history of African-American creativity. And also tying that to copyright and creative rights as human rights in essence. And of course, here's Dr. Martin Luther King, and there's no better person to help us understand what copyright justice and human rights mean than Dr. King. And of course, Dr. King also has been a part of copyright lawsuits, including the one over his signature speech in Washington, D.C. in 1963. I'm going to play a clip of it.
50 years ago, a great American in whose symbolic shadow we stand today, signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope to millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 100 years later, the Negro still is not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. 100 years later, the Negro lives on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. 100 years later, the Negro is still languished in the corners of American society and finds himself in exile in his own land.
So that, of course, is Martin Luther King's famous dream speech. And the themes that he raises there are unfortunately still with us today. And my work has really looked at how those themes continue in the space of music, particularly in African-American creativity. And that's what I'd like to talk about today. It's now more than 160 years later, based on Dr. King's speech, and many of those persistent problems exist. And we also still face, for example, an American music business that is, in for all intents and purposes, segregated. But there's a new awakening happening today, a new reality, which is Black Lives Matter. And I take the position, and my work has for the last 20 years, that if Black lives matter, then Black artists' lives matter. And the social change that we're looking at will sweep across the intellectual property space, including the copyright system, which is in desperate need of reform for its treatment of people at the bottom of the social ladder. In my work, I talk about the seven deadly sins of copyright, and we'll explore some of those themes today. There are things like copyright fixation. And of course, I have the Lion's King there on the side to illustrate it's a global problem, because that was a case in South Africa when in 1909, or right around in that time period, a Zulu tribesman named Solomon Linda created the melody, the Wimbawe melody, which many years later became a hit record in the 1960s for the Turtles. And then later on became a Disney theme song for The Lion King. And Solomon Linda was never paid fair compensation or anywhere near it, nor did he retain copyrights in his brilliant composition, Wimbawe. I talk about things like minimal originality and how super innovative artists like Jimi Hendrix and Louis Armstrong and Bessie Smith get less protection under copyright law. The idea expression dichotomy, which basically says you can't protect styles of playing music. Performance, we have a tremendous problem with underprotection of performers. The person who doesn't compose the song and therefore own the copyright, but the person who merely performs on a sound recording. They are generally left unprotected under American copyright law. Copyright formalities. These are things like copyright registration, deposit, notice, copyright terminations, all of these different formalities which require someone to really be diligent, to be wholly literate, almost to have legal training in order to obtain copyright protection, has been a major problem and has devastated African-American creativity. We can talk about moral rights. That's the right of a creator, not for the economic value of their work, but for the heart value, if you will. So using someone's work in a way that they vehemently disagree with, in a context that they disapprove of, is not protected generally under American copyright law, and certainly not in the music space. And of course, we can't think about copyright unless we think of its interface with contracts, because if you have a song, then you need a contract with a music producer or music distributor. And a lot of times that is where the real inequality has gone down in the contract copyright space. So we'll talk about all those things today. Copyright formalities. My work now is looking at copyright terminations. This is a provision in the Copyright Act which allows artists who've signed bad deals at the beginning of their career to recover those works 35 years later from the date that the copyright was transferred. And of course, one glimmer of hope we've seen in this space was people like Victor Willis here, who was the cop in The Village People. And he did this song, among others. We all know that song. It's YMCA, composed by Victor Willis, but copyright, in essence, appropriated by someone not the composer of the song, some producers that he worked with. And finally, after an epic struggle in the federal courts through the provisions of the copyright termination, he was able to wrest back his rights, or at least a portion of those rights, because there were other co-writers on that song, to YMCA, which basically makes him a millionaire. If you own the rights to YMCA, you could basically retire here in San Diego in a fancy neighborhood like Coronado. That's how music publishing works. So my work is exploring all these things. I'd like to explore them more in this talk and see how it is that someone, a composer like Victor Willis, ends up not only his copyright, which is the story. It's African American Legal Music History 101.
Make for the women. Jump and shout. Then the world wanna know. What is all about? What's going on?
That is the great Muddy Waters, and that was Hoochie Coochie Man. And of course, the people who created the blues, and many people don't realize that all the music that you listen to, Lady Gaga and Taylor Swift, all of them, it's all based on the blues. It's all blues, right? And then some jazz thrown in there. That music is the music that drives American society, American culture. But the people who created it were dirt poor people, usually from rural areas. They were illiterate many times, legally unsophisticated. And literally, the American music industry had a field day, basically filtering and taking these people's music and their copyrights and their compositions. And that is Music History 101. One of the things we look at in critical race theory, and by the way, I can't mention that in a federal presentation, according to Mr. Trump. I can't say anything about white supremacy. I can't say anything about white privilege. That is the law now, according to Mr. Trump's executive order. But guess what? I'm ignoring that order, and I always will ignore that order. That, you know, the critical race theory says, look, even though the law of copyright is race neutral, copyright doesn't mention race anywhere in the whole statute. But we all understand that even though a law doesn't say anything about race, it can have a racially disadvantaged effect. And that's been my position about copyright law going back, as I said, 20 years here in doing this work. I was at a conference, and this is just a couple of weeks ago. And at the conference, I was on the conference with Benta Brown, who's an amazing attorney up in Los Angeles, who's also doing a lot of activist work in this area, and also T.S. Monk. T.S. Monk is the son of the legendary Thelonious Monk. Thelonious Monk, if you don't know him, please go Google him, look him up, and listen to him. You need to know that. I'm sorry. I'm going to be harsh on people about that. If you don't know who Thelonious Monk is, that's a problem. Thelonious Monk is our Beethoven. He's, you know, he literally is. He's the Black Beethoven. What he did is every bit as great as what Beethoven did. And here's his signature song. Song, even though Thelonious Monk wrote it, he never profited off that song. And his son told me that, and I was so moved by that. His son said, T.S. Monk, who's a great musician in his own right, his son, he said, you know what, you would think that somebody who created some of the greatest jazz standards in history would be very rich, but I'm here to tell you that we were not rich. And why is that? Why do we have a system? He didn't own the copyright in the song that he wrote. Later on, his son revealed how he was able to get back parts of the copyright through Sony, because that was Columbia back in those days. Now it's Sony. He got it back because they wanted to make a movie and they needed some stuff from the estate. And I was astounded to hear that Round Midnight wasn't even owned by Monk, the person who wrote it. And this is the copyright justice I'm talking about, or we could call it copyright injustice. So let me tell you a little bit about my book. It's based on my son, he's around here somewhere, basically, a biracial teenager who's on his way to the Ivy League. Actually, he's already in the Ivy League. Now he's at Columbia. He's also a hip hopper. And like so many of our youth today, our youth of color, he is struggling with these issues of identity and the toll of racism. And by the way, I grew up, you know, in the 70s, when I thought it would be a lot worse, right? And I realize it's worse now, you know, when I look at it through the lens of my kids. And that's a profoundly sad thing to say, right? And that's why we have to keep doing this work and telling the story and fighting the fight, right? We can't give up the ship. He goes to a music exhibit because he wants to learn more about African-American music, what he thinks is, in a desolate part of town. But he takes a wrong turn and ends up at this place. It's a netherworld. It's like this underground, and it's called the Copyright House of Horrors, which is a metaphor for all the things I've been writing about in my heavy-duty scholarship. My scholarship, I was telling Diana, is one of my articles. It was so heavy that a lawyer who was actually well-versed in copyright, he said, oh man, I'm struggling to get to this article and understand it. And I said, oh boy, that's why I want to do this book, because I want to make all these concepts accessible just to ordinary people who aren't necessarily hardcore intellectual property lawyers. So that's the kind of premise of the book. And, you know, Brake is the protagonist of the book. Then suddenly this guy appears. I call him the guide. And he's this tall, grim man. And he basically grabs Brake and leads him into this, basically abducts him into this copyright house of horrors. And he says, steady, steady, my lad, the guide, chuckles sardonically. 'Tis not uncommon at all to stumble here. And indeed, few can negotiate these ways without faltering. Do you see it could not be otherwise? For you were in the presence of the law. And just as the reflections of the mirror of this room, things are not what they seem. And that is exactly a total metaphor for copyright law in African Americans. Things are not what they seem. Yes, you see Kanye West making a lot of money or Jay-Z, but I'm telling you, they are basically throwing peanuts from a trillion-dollar industry. And my work basically leads towards reparations, by the way, ultimately, you know, looking backwards for all that was taken. So in the Copyright House of Horrors, Brake, the biracial teenager, sees many things and exposed to many things. And he learns how these artists have been treated. And how these artists have been treated historically is shameful. It is dreadful. It is unconscionable. I don't know what words to use for it. Here's Jelly Roll Morton. Now, Jelly Roll Morton was quite a character, if you've read his history, and he claimed to have created jazz. I don't think any one person can say they created jazz, but I'll tell you what, he has a pretty strong claim that he is one of the, you know, prototypical creators of jazz. Here's his Black Bottom Stump. Black Bottom Stump by Jelly Roll Morton. And of course, if you read the life of Jelly Roll Morton, who, like I said, is this towering creator, an innovator, you know, of the first rate. And in his last days of his life, he's wandering around California, basically totally impoverished, doing odd jobs, working as a janitor. And he dies this, you know, as basically this unknown person who's one of the top creators of jazz, penniless. And it's heartbreaking because he's writing a series of letters back and forth to his music publisher, this guy called Melrose. And he's saying, hey man, where's my money? Where's my copyright royalties? He was gypped out of his copyright royalties. They took his money. And so this man died impoverished. Didn't even have a headstone. That stone you see was put there much later. This is a story of African-American music. I can tell you the same story for Scott Joplin, for Bessie Smith, and many more. And that's part of the Copyright House of Horrors. And so the question is, how did this happen and what to do about it, right? The two questions. But I stress this because, and I'm in academic presentations all the time. First of all, before I came along, no one talked about this at all, right? When I joined the IP Academy and I was considered a pariah, I was like, what the hell is this guy talking about? Now, thankfully, I'm the most popular guy in town, right? So the tables have turned, yes. But, you know, at the time, this hurts people. It's not just this academic, oh yeah, this theory and economic incentives. It's hurting people, and it's hurting people today in 2020, not just way back in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s. I want to be clear about that. So Brake meets an old man who had told him before he met the guide not to come in. I call him the last blues man. And he's a character that appears throughout the movie to kind of explain to him how things happen to these African-American artists. I think, you know, the last blues man maybe is a little bit of a cliche, but give me a better one if you got one, right? So he's blindfolded as he's let in. And that's a metaphor for the invisibility, the blindness of our IP system, our IP academy, IP scholars, judges. I talk to my students, I teach contracts, and I'm very frank. And I say, look, we give these judges so much power, but who are these judges? Well, today, they're almost, in the federal system anyway, they're 90% plus white, they're heavily male, they're people who came from wealthy backgrounds, went to Ivy League schools, they work at a big law firm maybe for a year, And yeah, by the way, I have that background too, right? But and then that's it. They're not representative of the people at all. This is a big problem that no one's talking about. We have these judges who don't understand African-American culture or music, and they're the ones who are making decisions about it. So there's a blindness there. And of course, that's straight out of Ralph Ellison, one of the greatest American novels, Invisible Man, where he talks about how African-Americans, even though we're so prominent in society and in music, we're invisible to people. And we still have that today. And hopefully that veil of invisibility is being lifted by this work. So in this scene, Brick goes and he's in this bar. It's like a 1920s bar, this old bar, having a drink with the guide in the Copyright House of Horrors. And he hears noise upstairs. He can hear music coming from upstairs, lofting in. As he climbs the stairs, up at the top of the bar are Prince, Madonna, and Michael Jackson. And they're having this incredible conversation about copyrights, contracts, and cultural appropriation. One of the things that Michael Jackson talks about is how, and a lot of people don't know this, and this is, by the way, by a black company, Motown. So, you know, don't understand. A lot of people don't understand, say, well, the black people did it too. Yeah, they learned it, right, from segregation and these race record labels. They learned how to, you know, rip off artists. So I don't say just because they're black, that doesn't mean there's not going to be ripoffs. You know, Michael Jackson talks about how when the Jackson 5 was fine, first of all, Joe Jackson, I think he's still alive, so don't let me get sued here, guys. I mean, he didn't know anything. I think he was like, not saying my family's working class too, right? My father's a bus driver, but I think he worked like in, you know, making boilers or something. And here he is, you know, with Berry Gordy, who's a pretty sharp guy, signing a contract, one of the worst contracts ever signed. Let me tell you how bad the Jackson 5 contract was. Of course, ABC was one of the, I think, five straight number one hits. No other group I don't think has done that. Maybe Drake now has done that. But almost no, five straight number one hits, including ABC, Stop the Love You Save, I'll Be There, we can go through them all. After they did all of that and they wanted to leave Motown, Berry Gordy said, okay, you want to leave Motown, bet. Number one, I'm keeping Jermaine because Jermaine married Berry Gordy's daughter. So he's not leaving. Number two, you could leave, but I want two things. One, you can't call yourself the Jackson 5 anymore because I own that. I own that trademark. And two, you've got to give me $500,000. What that is saying is that after all those hits that the Jackson 5 did, according to Motown, and this is Music Industry 101, they had not recouped, right, the money, the initial money they had been paid out, which of course is totally false. Of course they had. So they talk about that. And of course, there's Prince there too. He tells his story. Doesn't love Prince, and that's a great song, Kiss. And so, of course, Prince famously or infamously put Slave on his face because he was so unhappy with his Warner Brothers deal. But in the book, he realizes after he's been told that in order to get $150 million, which was a record-breaking deal, he wanted his deal to be bigger than Michael Jackson's and Madonna's. By the way, they were very much rivals, right? Very much in rivalry with each other. What he didn't realize is in order to receive the $150 million, there were conditions. And he basically have to do like two or three more Purple Rains because he signed this contract after Purple Rain. And he never came close to Purple Rain sales. And so he never got the 150. And he was very upset about that. He was also upset that Warner wouldn't just let him release music whenever he wanted because the music industry doesn't allow that. They have a schedule that music's released, right? And then of course, Prince and Michael Jackson kind of jump on Madonna about cultural appropriation.
What are you looking at?
Signature song. And of course, Prince kind of takes her to task saying, where did you learn Vogue? Vogue was something that was done in the underground dance clubs in New York City, black dance clubs. And this is a thing that persists right today in society. And I don't really know, in Q&A, maybe we can talk about what to do with it. Because on the one hand, we don't want to take away people's free expression. On the other hand, it seems kind of wrong almost, right? That, you know, these black men and women who pioneered this Vogue dancing, they kind of find themselves subsumed in Madonna, and people think that she created it when she didn't. And I do have a little bit of a problem with that. By the way, Prince calls her out in my book saying, hey, why you only mention white people in Vogue? You took it from black folks. You could at least put some Grace Kelly, right? Gene Kelly, Fred Astaire, et cetera. So it's kind of a funny, it's kind of tongue in cheeky. But, you know, that's the issue that we face right now. Of course, Madonna has been called on that. And whenever she is, she pretty much says, kiss my ass. She has said that publicly, right? But she doesn't care about that. So as a billionaire, I don't think she's probably too concerned with what I have to say either. After that, there's a curtain, and this is an old smoky bar, and it's like those old red, you know, garish red curtains. And behind the curtain, the young African-American youth can hear music playing.
Spending my money, I didn't care. I carried my friends out for a good time, buying bootleg liquor, champagne, and wine.
All right, so that she's Bessie Smith, considered the greatest blues singer of all time. I don't think there's any dispute over that, even though there's some other great blues singers. And that is the anthem of the Great Depression, which might be apropos for kind of like the period we're going in as well. It is very true that no one does want to know you when you're down and out. Absolutely, absolutely true. So, you know, what people don't realize is Bessie Smith created Columbia Music, which is Sony today, by the way. Okay, Sony. There's three major record labels. Sony is one of them. People don't realize it was actually two black women who started the American recording industry that got lost in the sauce in the 1920s. One was Bessie Smith, right? Who you heard her, and that's a great song. No one knows who's down and out. And this is the other Smith. Mamie Smith. That's Crazy Blues by Mamie Smith, 1920. It sold a bunch of records, and guess what? People were watching saying, wow, there's a market. This started in the African-American community, and these two women basically launched the American music industry. But if you look at Bessie Smith, and she tells her story in the book, she got, she made money, by the way, as a performer. She did make compensation, but in terms of the copyright side, she signed flat fee contracts. She got one-time payments, and her manager, who worked at Columbia as well, completely unethical, by the way, FYI, owned all those copyrights. And we know this because it's a 1973 case by one of the purported heirs to try to get those rights back. The answer was no. This is the American music business that we know. These great foundational artists. Bessie Smith also died with no tombstone. Later on, a charitable organization got a tombstone for her. Next, there's a section in the book where he encounters these people. I call them the lackeys of the man. I wanted to call them the minions of the man. But the minions is now mean something, right, in the cartoon world or whatever. So I said, I better call them something else. These are the people who make the system run. And the point of this is that he sees all these documents, you know, copyright registrations, copyright mortgages, forms, contracts. This is what makes the system go. And one of the reasons why African-American artists don't win this game is that the man has all the paperwork. He knows what to do. He knows how to do it. And they don't. And just to give you some example of how important this is. That is the great George Clinton. George Clinton is the king of funk. And for those of you who like hip hop, you don't have hip hop unless you have George Clinton and James Brown, because they are the architects. They are the backbone, right, of hip hop music. And of course, I had the privilege of working with George Clinton about 4 or 5 years ago. And we went up to the Ninth Circuit. And in the Ninth Circuit took away his music and gave it to a law firm that he owed money to, which I thought was the greatest travesty. But the point was that this paperwork that these lackeys do is critical. Warner Brothers is smart. And so when Warner Brothers signed him to a record deal, they make him promise that all his sound recordings they produce for him aren't owned by him. They call it a work made for hire. They're not, by the way, we could talk about that later. And we got to the Ninth Circuit. The Ninth Circuit said, well, tell you what, these are Warner Brothers sound recordings. The copyright certificate says work made for hire. And we're like, no, you can't just do that. You can't just look at what was put in this form, but that's exactly what happens. That is exactly how the system works. And that's how you, most of the time, these artists get beat 9 times out of 10. Next, these guys, the guide and the last blues man and break the biracial kid, go to what I call the unguarded fortress, which is the US Copyright Office. Now, I have been ranting and railing about this. And I somehow wonder, is my ranting and railing getting through, even though they won't give me credit for it? I saw that the Registrar of the Copyright, that's the head of the Copyright Office, last year said, copyright is a social justice issue. And I was like, where'd you hear that? Right now, all of a sudden, it's a social justice issue. So things seem to be changing, but not fast enough. The metaphor for the Copyright Office is it's an unguarded fortress. It's a very strong fortress, as you can see in the slide, you know, for those who know how to get inside, right, and manipulate the system. But it's unguarded in the sense that the Copyright Office, unlike the Trademark Office, does not vet these forms to make sure, number one, that the people who are claiming they own copyright own it. This is a major, major project of mine. And this is a radical position, I understand that. But I take the position that the US Copyright Office has no credibility because we don't know what's in there in these registered forms, who really owns that work and who doesn't. And this is particularly prevalent with African-American artists. Let me play you a song that indicates that. Signed to Motown Records. His name is Barrett Strong. He wrote this song called Money, That's What I Want, which became a number one hit for Motown. I forget the year, 64, whatever the year was. And you can hear in Barrett Strong, he's presaging the Beach Boys with that sound, that rolling sound and the drums and everything. The Beach Boys were listening. They said, oh, we want to play like that. By the way, that's not copyright infringement. You're allowed to do that. You can do that under our system. So Berry Gordy, who's a pretty good songwriter and musician himself, we'll give him that. He claims to be a co-writer on this song too. And so when they register the song, this is before it becomes a hit, they register it as Barrett Strong and Berry Gordy as the composers on the copyright certificate, the copyright form. Then after the song becomes a hit, Berry Gordy or somebody at Motown goes to the copyright office, takes Barrett Strong off the copyright. And for 25 years, 30 years, Barrett Strong was not getting anything off of that song. Finally, at the end of his life, and I think he only lived to be about 60 or something, he got some money, right? Because, you know, he was able to reach a settlement with them. By the way, this happened all the time. The people who write the songs aren't necessarily the ones who should be on the copyright certificate. And that happens all the time. The dungeon of performance. The next stop in the copyright house of horrors is they come to a dungeon, right? This dingy dungeon. And there's a woman in there that they could hear. They could hear her singing as they come in the distance. And let me tell you what she was singing. My baby. The group is the Ronettes, and the lead singer is Ronnie. Or also, she became Ronnie Spector. So Mr. Phil Spector was a major producer, and the man was a genius. Can't take that away from him. He created this wall of sound, which became a very influential thing in the 60s and is still with us today. But he was also not a good person, I think, by all accounts at all. And so she's in the dungeon of performance as a metaphor for how terrible copyright law treats people who only perform, right? Because she only sang on the record. She didn't compose Be My Baby. Phil Spector composed the song. And I say, why do we do this in our copyright system? What is the song without her performance? It's nothing. You could say, what is her performance without the song? Nothing. It's equal. Why do we have a system that says only the writer of the song has rights and the person who sings on the song has no rights? Let me tell you how much no rights she had. When she wanted to do a play on Broadway, which is a retrospective of her amazing life and all the things that she accomplished, you know, the Beatles were in awe of her. And that song knocked the Beatles off the chart, which almost no one could do, Be My Baby. Because they were absolutely enamored of her and the rest of the group. When she wanted to do that play, in order to play those songs, she has to go to Mr. Spector to get the rights. Mr. Spector, the same man who she alleges abused her, who kept her prisoner basically in a Beverly Hills mansion. She couldn't leave or go anywhere without his permission. And of course, he also got charged with a murder, I believe, right? I don't know if he's still sitting in jail or he died, what his status is. But when she asked him that, he said, no, I will not give you the rights. So she could not perform her signature song, Be My Baby, in a play about her life. That is criminal. This is wrong. You know, we have to have a completely different treatment of performers. Not only that, performance is the thing that's very important in African-American music. Let me give you an example. Everybody get up. So the first song was Blurred Lines. Of course, Pharrell and Robin Thicke got sued for copyright infringement by the Gay Estate for infringing Got to Give It Up by Marvin Gaye. And of course, when this guy came to the court told the jury, you can't listen to the record in court, right, as part of the lawsuit. Why? Why? Because that's not what was at issue. The issue was the composition, Got to Give It Up. And only that could be listened to, played on a single instrument or whatever. This is absurd and shows you how badly performance is treated. Look, Marvin Gaye did Got to Give It Up. He didn't want to do it, first of all. He only did it because Motown said, we need a disco song. He kind of did it as an FU to them, in essence, and it became a number one hit in 1977. He went into the studio. This is how black music is made. They went into the studio, they jammed. At the end, someone from Warner Brothers said, hey, somebody needs to write those lyrics down. And that's what goes in the copyright certificate. And yet the court said that's the only thing that the jury can listen to. It's an absurd, absurd system that we have here. What's special about Got to Give It Up isn't the lyrics. It's Marvin Gaye's performance. And performance is highly undervalued in American copyright law. That's something that needs to change. Break is captured in the fortress of copyright by the Register of Copyrights. And he's told that he needs to go and catch this renegade, this copyright terminator, take his mace, which is a medieval kind of device, and bring it to him. It's almost like the Wizard of Oz, almost kind of like a little pun on that. And of course, the copyright terminator lives high in his palace of copyright terminations. He's an austere creature who basically executes artists, because that's what copyright terminations do, right? Copyright terminator is not there to help people terminate. He's there to make sure that they don't ever terminate and recapture their works. Ultimately, he turns traitor and helps Brake in his quest to break out of the copyright house of horrors. I don't want to give away the whole book here, right? And the book will end. There's parts of it I didn't discuss. There's this activist radical law professor, IP law professor, who I call Professor Sister now, Professor Tamara Sister. But my wife tells me I probably should change the name. But I like kind of Professor Sister. Professor Sister is a black academic who's been railing against the system. And she also helps Brake, the character, get out of the copyright house of horrors. And the conclusion of the book, which isn't finished, is they're going to put copyright on trial in it, kind of reminiscence of NWA, right?
Right about now, NWA court is in full effect. Judge Dre resides. the police department, prosecuting attorneys are MC Ren, Ice Cube, and Easy motherfucking E.
Order, order, order. Ice Cube, take the motherfucking stand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help your black ass?
You goddamn right.
Won't you tell everybody what the fuck you gotta say?
Fuck the police, coming straight from the underground. A young nigga got it bad, cause I'm brown.
That song actually is a trial. And so at the end, we're going to put copyright on trial. We're going to bring these judges out and, you know, make sure that they understand what's happening. And at the end of the day, there are going to be reparations. By the way, the reparations conversation is getting very serious now. And I'm kind of at the center of that. Maybe I have a target on my back, maybe not. But, you know, Warner Brothers has given $100 million for reinvestment in the Black community. Wonderful. Universal, $25 billion. Wait a minute. $25 million? Universal? I mean, Drake makes that in one day for you guys. You're going to give $25 million? So I don't understand what Universal is doing. Of course, it's not acceptable. Number one, the music industry needs to apologize for all the things that they did. And that has not happened. I think BMG made something of an apology just recently over the summer. And number two, they've got to pay off, right? Because otherwise, things aren't going to change, whether it's music or society. Reparations is going to have to be part of this conversation. Okay, I'm about done with what I want to say. I think here I'm going to open it up for questions, if that's okay.
Oh, thank you so much. I think this was a very fascinating take on the topic. And we do have some questions. In present day, like, what is some maybe advice for artists who kind of find themselves in the same position as some of these other artists that you mentioned, like in the 1900s or the creation of blues and jazz? It's kind of like not that different for folks that have no clue, right?
It's still going on, Diana, right now, as we speak, right?
So
what's
like,
old is new again. Really has not changed much. So what can be done? Well, first of all, I believe we need reform. Now, you know, I have my kid's 20 now, and he's a character for Break. And I so admire what they're doing, their passion. He's at every demonstration, you know, every police protest. Sometimes I worry terribly about him because sometimes these things get violent. And so when I say reform, my kids automatically turn off. No, we don't want reform. We want to tear the whole thing down, right? I respect that. And we need that. We need that youthful dynamism, right? To push it. The civil rights movement was pushed by one was 20, one was 21, and I think one was 19. Three gentlemen in Greensboro, North Carolina. They refuse to sit to leave that counter in Greensboro. And by the way, that's what ignited the civil rights movement. Yes, Martin Luther King was out there, but Martin Luther King wasn't pushing like that. Those kids were way ahead of it. The kids are always going to be ahead of it, right? In every movement. So that's beautiful. I'm still talking about reform because I want to help people today. And I realize this is not going to happen overnight, the reform. In South Africa, they're actually doing it. Because I've been talking with the South Africans. They invite me in their conferences and everything. And they are changing their copyright law to say you must provide fair compensation. Can you imagine that? That if you're a record label, you have to provide fair compensation. We don't have that in American law. There's no provision for that. The registration thing is a mess because a lot of people are now afraid to even put their works out there knowing what a ripoff the system is. This is not good for creativity. That they're laying low saying, I don't want to get involved in a system that kind of eats people like a machine. So that's something else that I think we really need to work on. And I've been talking about copyright terminations because at least that is a way looking back for someone who created a work 35 years ago, for them to get something today. And many of them have absolutely nothing. That's very, very important to me.
Perfect, thank you. What do you think is the best way to educate or inform Black musicians and artists across America as to their rights and even how to advocate for themselves?
Well, first of all, there isn't really any organization that does that. So creating an organization that does that would be, I think, important. And maybe Warner Brothers and Sony and the companies with some of the money they're throwing. I think some of it's supposed to go to that. But I'll be honest with you, the system is rigged. So even if you're well educated, you can't win unless you reach a level of a Drake or, you know, a Jay-Z and those people. And by the way, once those guys reach that level, I feel like they just forget about everybody else, right? And they really, Kanye, they don't really care anymore at that point. One of my proposals for copyright terminations, which is very important for if you were a rapper in the 1980s, early 90s, to be able to get your rights back. I mean, Push It is a commercial, right? Push It, right? Salt and Pepper. They don't own those rights. Somebody else wrote the song. That's making a ton of money. So the money is there for these artists. But I think the copyright office should do a public service announcement to every artist to explain what termination rights are, to actually let people know, hey, if you file a copyright in these years, you're eligible to recapture your work. They should be doing that. And they're not doing it right now. Now, I don't think that, you know, big companies have any interest in that, because these big companies are going to get rich again. They rip the artists off on the front end with a bad contract, and on the back end, they end up owning the work. And what kind of system is this? So we do need education about that. And can they abdicate? I'm sorry, but I'm a little pessimistic about that. I got a management contract from somebody the other day, and I'm looking at this contract, and I'm saying, there's no way just an ordinary person can understand this contract. They just can't do it. Now, I've been doing this for years, so I look at it automatically. I say, this is wrong, that's wrong, you need this. But it's going to be very difficult for an ordinary person to do this. The system isn't made for us to do it. It's deliberate. It took me all this time to realize it's deliberate how the system is set up. You're not meant to understand it. It helps the people who are in power that you don't understand it.
Yeah, and I think it goes back to your mention of this being a social justice issue. And I think I know our work with CLA is also to do that, right? To do some of that kind of educating and making these concepts that I think are often foreign to most folks, especially and specifically historically underrepresented communities. This is, you know, probably not something that you're learning in school, obviously, unless you're, you know, a law student. If an organization pays a teaching artist to create curriculum, who owns the curriculum?
That's a really good question. The answer is pretty simple, that if you are an employee, hired as an employee, then the employer owns the work. So the Disney animators, people who work at Disney and they do animation, or Netflix who do film editing, they don't own that. Netflix owns or Disney owns it. And so if the person is actually an employee, but they really have to be an employee, that's the thing, right? Then the employer owns it. If they're getting a salary, if they're getting benefits, et cetera, the employer owns it. The other one is tougher because there's something called specially commissioned works under copyright. That's another way that somebody else is going to become an owner of somebody else's work who's not working for them, but is just coming in one time to do things. We call those specially commissioned works. Now, there are 9 categories of specially commissioned works that are enumerated in the Copyright Act. There are things like maps, encyclopedias, movies are there, audiovisual works, TV shows. So if you work on a TV show, even though you're not an employee of the show, you're not getting a salary, they're hiring you, they're paying you a one-time payment, you develop this, they own it, but it has to fall in those 9 categories. Let me tell you what's not in that category. Literary works are not in that category. That means books, pamphlets, writings are not in that category. They are not specially commissioned works. Also, sound recordings are not there. Even though the record labels try to say that they are, works made for hire, especially commissioned works, and also musical compositions. So musical compositions, as opposed to the sound recording, because those are different copyrights, are also not listed there. The import of that is that even if you signed away your rights to somebody in a contract, you can recapture those rights. But if it really is a work made for hire, either way, it's owned forever by that party. So that's the key distinction there.
Do you feel that adding a sworn affidavit under penalty of perjury would help reform copyright law or requirements? Also, would even adding such a step still be a stumbling block for minority creators?
That's a really good question. So you don't have to, when you file copyright, it's not under penalty of perjury. It doesn't say that in the form. However, there is a statute that goes along with the copyright statute that says that if you file a false copyright registration, you can be fined. And you know how much the fine is? I think the maximum is the princely sum of $2,500. I told you about Berry Gordy and Money. That song made a fortune for Motown. You'll take that deal, right? You'll take that deal of taking somebody's copyright and pay the $2,500 fine is like chump change. Technically, the copyright also could be taken away from that party. Let me tell you something. That is the most difficult thing you're going to try to do. Once someone actually has a copyright registration, trying to reverse that registration is going to be one of the hardest things you're going to have to do. You're going to have to show that you committed fraud on the copyright office, and it's going to be tough. And it's wrong, right? That these copyright registrations are worship. It's a fetish. They fetishized, right? That this is it. I almost am at the point, Diana, to think maybe it would be better if we didn't have a copyright registration system at all. I'm that kind of sour on it. And I wasn't always like that, but I've kind of come to that place seeing what I see. Artists don't register, first of all. That's number one. I get, you know, a rapper, a filmmaker. I don't know how these people find me. Rare is the week that somebody doesn't call. And I talk to everybody right away because I feel like that's my way of giving back. I'm not going to represent them, but I'll say, okay, great, this, that, and the other thing. And they always say, oh, guess what? Diddy took my song. And it's exactly my song. And my first question is, do you have a registration?
No.
Here's what one of them told me. No, dog, I don't need a registration. Wrong. You need a registration. You need a registration. I say this a million times in my class. You need a registration. It's non-negotiable.
Sorry, Professor, just to interject there quickly, because I know, for example, when I've heard more like just educational workshops on intellectual property, the presenter will say, well, you're protected because if you're the creator, but then we have to go through this process of showing.
That's absurd. Those people are absurd. They're ridiculous. They're not, to me, they're not serious people. They don't understand how the industry works. Tell you what, I'm revealing some trade secrets here, but because one day I would like to actually work on this, but these reggae is the worst ever. As bad as these black artists were treated way back in the day, you know, in 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, these reggae artists, even today, it is the worst thing. It's unbelievable, the treatment that they go through, the ripoffs that they go through. So this reggae guy I know, Arasta, he comes to me and I've spent a lot of time with him. And finally I said, look, I can't do this, you know, I without compensation. I helped you a lot, but so finally I said, enough is enough. He wants to go to all these big companies, Netflix and, you know, Warner Brothers, Sony, and present this catalog. And I'm like, unless you have registration in every sound recording, they are not going to talk to you. No one at Netflix or Sony is going to talk to you. Hey, I got all this great stuff, right? Where's your copyright? Where's your registration? Sorry. Also, right off the bat, that just shows you that you're not the person they want to deal with. The registration is everything in the world of copyright and music and entertainment. So you got to have it. Those people shouldn't be saying that. Now, it is true that copyright protection begins when you fix the work, but it's wrong to say that you have protection. The Supreme Court came out with a case last year. It's called the Fourth Estate case. And in that case, they settled the question if it was okay to sue if you only had the form filled out but had not yet granted by the copyright office. Supreme Court said, no way. You got to have a fully blown registration that's stamped by the U.S. Copyright Office. Now, when they did that, they were so cavalier. And that's what I'm saying. The judges are a big part of it, too. You know, we don't spend enough time. These judges, they don't understand Black music. I don't think they understand Black people, most of them. I'm just being honest. I'm just shooting straight. And so they, you know, when they make the decision, and here's what they said, well, you can always go and register later. Yeah, but the clock is ticking. The statute of limitations doesn't stop because you need time to get a registration, which could take 6 months. And I almost want to go up to the Supreme Court and, you know, grab them by the chapelle and say, what are you thinking? Do you know who this hurts? And the same thing with all these academics who are out there saying, oh, we need stronger copyright registration. We need more formalities. You know, they're at Columbia. They're at all these schools. Like, wait a minute. Do you realize who this hurts? I'm the only academic, or one of the few. I don't want to say the only. I don't want to be Mr. Trump. I'm the only one. But I'm one of the few academics that actually tries to bring this to the world. This is hurting people. It is not a theoretical debate that we can sit around as egg-headed professors and, oh, yes, well, the incentive theories. Well, the economic. What about the dynamics of this? What about all the people getting hurt and getting destroyed? How about we talk about that?
How can minority creators in the digital space navigate the minefield of recent DMCA claims, given that they are just ordinary people who are not necessarily savvy on the precise legalities of playing music in their online content?
Right. So just for reference to everybody else, the Digital Millennium Copyright Act was an act that was done back in 1998. And it basically was trying to determine who should be liable for what on the internet. The compromise that came is that the internet service provider, your Verizon or whoever your internet is, not liable generally because you posted some infringing material. But they are liable if they've been given notice of it. They can become liable. And when they get notice that someone has uploaded an infringing work, a photo, a song, they'll send a notice. We call that a DMCA takedown notice. And that notice says you need to take down that work because it's infringing my copyright. Now, I haven't worked in that space for a while because of all the other stuff I'm doing, but I do feel like that is kind of a travesty that a lot of people do DMCA takedowns and they don't really have the right to take down that material. It could be fair use. By the way, the company, Verizon or whoever the service provider is supposed to make a determination, is it fair use? If it's fair use, it should stay. But a lot of times it comes down and then you have to file a counter notice. As the person whose work was taken down, you got to file a counter notice. But guess what? If you file that counter notice, you just opened yourself up to be sued. because that's the next step, is you're going to get sued for copyright infringement potentially. So it's a kind of a dangerous thing to do. And most people don't do it. They just let it slide and say, okay, great, it comes down. That's not my specialty, but I think that's also a big travesty in copyright law. I don't think it affects minority artists more than others, though. At least I've seen no evidence of that.
Do you have any experience or comment regarding the marginalization of Black folks in the video game entertainment industry?
I mean, first of all, that's a great question. And no, the general answer is no. I did music and I did film and TV, and I never did video games. Now, I'm going to video game conferences because I teach entertainment law and I need to teach that in my classes, but I've looked at the contracts, et cetera. Here's how I'm thinking about that. Unlike the music world, which is, you know, dominated by Black creativity, you know, on pretty much from soup to nuts, the video game world, in my experience, those people is they're much more nerdy. They're like almost like patent people, right? I've gone to video game conferences where they won't talk to you. And I was like, why won't they talk to me? I said, oh, they're socially awkward. I get it. You know, that's why they're not talking. So that's a great question. I think it's an area that I don't think anybody's writing about. So I don't know if the questioner is in the legal space, that would be a great area to write about and explore. You know, one can't do everything, right?
I thought all art was taken from some other person or place. How does that mesh with the modern concept of appropriation?
First of all, appropriation is a tough concept because I've never seen a wonderful definition of what cultural appropriation is. I still don't have a really great working definition of that. But let me say this, that some people have said that in terms of Black music. Oh, well, you know, everybody takes from everybody else. A couple of responses to that. One is the striking one-way direction historically of it. Striking one-way direction. We don't hear typically about African-American artists appropriating from white artists. And yes, it happens. I'm not saying it never happens. But that is the story of, that's music history 101. You know, rock and roll is Black music that was played by white people. That's all that it is. And it was often created and sung by. Have you ever heard of Otis Blackwell?
Well, bless my soul, but what's wrong with me? I'm itching like a man on a fuzzy tree. My friends say I'm acting wild as a bug. I'm in love. I'm all shook up. Ooh, ooh. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, my hands shake.
So that's one of Elvis's biggest hits. Now, Elvis is a great artist, by the way. I don't take away from that. I think he was a fabulous artist. But Elvis, that song was written by Otis Blackwell, who wrote many of his songs, many of Elvis's biggest hits, an African-American that most people have never heard of. If you listen to Otis Blackwell, if you go on YouTube or you go on Spotify, you can find Otis Blackwell. Listen to Otis Blackwell sing, and you will see that Elvis Presley copied Otis Blackwell's vocalizations word for word. Elvis Presley did not write songs, yet all the songs that he did with Otis Blackwell are copyrighted as Elvis Presley and Otis Blackwell. Remember I was saying about the system has no accountability, the registration system? How is it we allow that? And why does Otis Blackwell, as many African-American artists, have to cough up half the copyright? You know, now Otis Blackwell said he was happy about that because he made money and Elvis made money. So maybe for some it's fine. By the way, the modern day version of this isn't whites against blacks. It's artists, I shouldn't name artists, right? Well, let me say allegedly, purportedly. Beyonce has been on that list, and I don't want to single her out because I know there's the hive, but basically, these artists, like at that level, they are not writing these songs. Somebody else is writing them and they're taking the credit. That's a very old problem, which I think, you know, needs to be solved and is wrong for it to happen. By the way, as far as I know, Beyonce has denied that. She says, no, that hasn't happened. But there are persistent rumors about that happening. So, you know, those are some of the things that are happening and some of the changes that I think really have to be made. And by the way, I am, for the first time, I'm kind of optimistic that some of these changes are going to happen. The music industry is listening. This is a music which is, you know, not a diverse industry at all in terms of who the major players are and who's making things happen. It's built on Black creativity. They can't last a day without your Drakes and, you know, all the rest of the people making that music. So this is an area which could change. We could see some changes.
Thank you so much, Professor. I know that I'm like kind of going in a bunch of different directions, right? And that's like us talking about, you know, the United States and America, but I know that this kind of same concept of appropriation and misappropriation translates to like Latin America and the popular music that we know in many cultures is oftentimes, you know, traced back to Black or Indigenous communities are kind of like left out of the puzzle. So I thought it was fascinating.
There's a difference between collaboration and appropriation. I guess that's where I would draw the line. You know, now in terms of jazz, as you know, jazz is heavily influenced by, you know, the Caribbean and Latin America, including people like Thelonious Monk. So, and also, I don't know how I feel about this, but we could say that it's like in community versus out of community. So among people in the community, an African-American culture is African-based. So it's communal-based in that sense, or historically was. They might share among themselves. They might share, you know, verses and rhymes. That happened in the blues all the time. The beef I have to the questioner is when somebody else outside of that culture comes in, takes it, capitalizes it, profits on it, and the people who created it get nothing and they're forgotten. That's the problem I have. And we see that all over the world, not only in the United States.
Well, thank you everyone for joining us today. I thought that this was a fascinating lecture. Professor Greene, I know that we've been wanting to have you speak with us for some time. Hopefully we'll have you speak again.
If people want to follow me, I'm Hip Hop Law Prof on Instagram.